Hello and welcome to the UCL Centre for Anaesthesia student podcasts in the critically ill patient. Today we're going to look at how to systematically approach a patient who's presenting with breathlessness after surgery and think about using the National Early Warning Score to help identify critically ill patients and using it to escalate the care of those patients to your senior team. Mrs. Mehta is a 76-year-old lady who's had an elective laparotomy and right hemicolectomy 2 days ago. She didn't have any intraoperative complications and she only lost about 300 mils in blood. She's got a past medical history of hypertension and type 2 diabetes, which is tablet controlled, but she's otherwise fit and well. You're called to see her because she's suddenly become breathless on the ward. Press pause now and write down 5 causes of breathlessness that you can think of in this lady. As you arrive on the ward, you're handed some blood results. So her haemoglobin's a bit low at 102, but that's unlikely to be causing her breathlessness. Her white cell count's slightly up at 12.5. Now, that may be a marker of infection, but we often see white cell counts up after surgery as just part of an inflammatory response to the operation. Her sodium and potassium are normal, and her CRP is elevated at 142. Now, again, that may be just a non-specific marker of inflammation following surgery, or maybe an early sign that there may be an infection going on. As you approach the end of the bed, you can see Mrs. Mehta's working quite hard with her breathing. She's got a respiratory rate of 22, and as you look at the OBS chart, you see that her saturations are 92% on air. A blood pressure of 102 over 68 may be low for her, so it's important to look at the trend over the past few hours to see if this is going down or going up. She's also tachycardic with a heart rate of 110. She's got a high temperature of 38.7, and that may be contributing to her increased heart rate. Her blood sugar of 8.2 is okay after surgery. We generally aim for something between 4 and 10. And her urine output of 18 mils an hour is low. Remember, we like to see anything between 0.5 mils to 1 mil per kilo per hour after an operation. So you need to start thinking about what's going on. The National Early Warning Score, or NEWS score, will help you in assessing the severity of a patient's illness. By adding up the score for each observation, you're able to determine quite how sick the patient is. A score of 5 or more makes the patient medium to high risk, and you need to be thinking about calling your seniors early. Press pause now and add up Mrs. Mehta's score and see what you think about the severity of her illness. She scores a score of 7 on the NEWS score, and that makes her at high risk of deterioration. Based on the information so far, list 5 possible causes for her breathlessness. Press pause now and write them down. At the top of the list, I've got hospital-acquired pneumonia. She's got low oxygen saturations, a high fever, and she's got markers of infection or inflammation. Second on my list is atelectasis. This is the partial collapse or incomplete inflation of the lung and is very common after surgery. It would account for the low oxygen saturations, but wouldn't necessarily explain the fever or the tachycardia. Third is pulmonary edema. It can be caused by many factors. Has the patient had too much fluid postoperatively? Why don't you have a look at the fluid chart and check the fluid balance? Fourth is pulmonary embolism. Again, very common after major surgery, and patients can often present with low oxygen sats, a high respiratory rate, a mild fever, and also a sinus tachycardia. It's an important one not to miss. The last on my list is sepsis. Aside from her chest, think about intra-abdominal or urinary sources of sepsis. Sepsis would fit with a high heart rate, high temperature, high respiratory rate, and low oxygen saturations. Now let's look at our examination findings and see if we can narrow down our differential. Don't forget, when you're assessing a critically ill patient, use the doctor ABCDE approach. When you touch the patient, she feels warm and slightly clammy. Heart sounds are normal. There's mild pitting edema to the ankles and her calves are soft and non-tender, so there's no signs clinically of a DVT at this stage. She has coarse crepitations in her right base and it's dull to percussion, with increased tactile vocal fremitus. Her abdomen is soft, non-tender, there's normal bowel sounds, and her midline incision wound looks clean. She's alert and orientated and moving all four limbs. Her pulses are all palpable, and we know her urine output was 18 mils for the last hour, but it's now time to think about what her fluid balance is. Okay, so what's your top differential now? Press pause and write it down. I now want you to think about what investigations you're going to organise immediately. Try and categorise your investigations and be systematic in how you're going to organise them, as this will avoid you missing anything out. So I always think of things as blood, urine, sputum, radiological investigations and ECG in any sick patient. You're going to send a full blood count and maybe some clotting. You want to know what her renal function is and her other electrolytes such as calcium and magnesium. She's got a fever, so you want to send some blood cultures. Doing an arterial blood gas will not only tell you more about her oxygenation, but also her ventilation and her metabolic status. A raised lactate is a marker of severe illness. You need to dip and send the urine looking for signs of infection. If she's got a productive cough, you need to send the sputum to microbiology. You've heard crackles on her right base, so she needs a chest x-ray. And you need to do an ECG, looking to see what rhythm her heart is in and also if there's any signs of ischemia given her tachycardia. Have a look at her arterial blood gas. Press pause now and write down what you think it shows. So she's got a normal pH, so she's not acidotic. She's got a normal PCO2. She's got a low PO2. Her bicarbonate is just below the normal range. She's got a slightly increased base excess, but her lactate is normal. So in summary, Mrs. Mehta is hypoxemic, but she doesn't yet meet the criteria for type 1 respiratory failure, as we know that type 1 respiratory failure is defined as having a PO2 of less than 8 kilopascals with a normal or low PCO2. Look at this ECG. Remember, you need to be systematic in your approach to interpreting ECGs in order to avoid overlooking important abnormalities. Press pause and write down your interpretation now. So looking at the ECG, firstly, the rate is approximately 150 beats per minute using the quick method, where you divide 300 by the number of large squares between two fixed points in the QRS, such as the R wave. There are approximately two squares between two R waves, so 300 divided by 2 is 150. The rhythm, well, there are no obvious P waves, so this isn't sinus rhythm. However, the complexes are regular and the complexes are narrow, taking up a maximum of two small squares, which is approximately 80 milliseconds. That's normal because we know that for a QRS to be prolonged or abnormal, it's got to be over at least 100 milliseconds. And to be classified as broad, it has to be over 120 milliseconds or three small squares on an ECG. Finally, looking at the T wave and ST segments, there's essentially no ST depression or T wave inversion, except in AVR and V1, where T wave inversion is normal. So in summary, I hope you guys have written down something along the lines of that this is a tachycardic ECG with a heart rate of about 150. It's a narrow complex tachycardia. There are no P waves or atrial flutter seesaw waves or abnormal P waves. And so it's most likely a junctional or AV nodal tachycardia. Now we're going to move on and have a look at a chest x-ray. Okay guys, so now have a little look at this chest x-ray and press pause and write down what you think the abnormality is. Remember, use a systematic approach to looking at your chest x-rays. A common one is doctor's ABCDE, where the D stands for details, the R stands for ripe, so looking at image quality, so rotation, inspiration, picture and exposure. S stands for soft tissues and bone. Don't forget to look at the clavicles, looking at the breast outline if there is one. Look at the humeral head and look at the ribs. A, obviously for airway and mediastinum. Track the trachea down, looking for any deviation into the mediastinum, looking for any air. Breathing, look for lung fields, look at the pleura, look for any pneumothoraces. Circulation, look at the heart, look at the heart size.
position, look at the aortic knuckle. Then D, diaphragm. So look at both hemidiaphragms. Remember, the right hemidiaphragm can be higher than the left hemidiaphragm normally, up to 1.5 to 2 centimetres higher. And then E stands for extras. So always consider whether there's an endotracheal tube and whether it's in the right main bronchus or not. Look for lines, such as a central line, and look for chest drains or even pacemakers and pacemaker wires. So it's important to be systematic in your assessment of chest x-rays, but it's also important to say what the most striking abnormality is. So if you're to come and present this x-ray to me, I'd expect you to tell me that there's an area of consolidation in the right lower lung field that is obliterating the right heart border, but the right hemidiaphragm is still visible. So in summary, there is consolidation in the right middle lobe and potentially affecting the lower lobe. And in the context of this patient, it's most likely going to be pneumonia. But always think about whether this could be fluid or even pulmonary hemorrhage, so blood. Now we're going to talk about what we'll do as our initial management plan. So the first thing you should think about doing is giving the patient oxygen. You can give it simply via a face mask, or can consider nasal cannula, or even a non-rebreath bag with 15 litres if you're concerned that this patient needs urgent high-flow oxygen. Consider adding in nebulizers, such as a saline nebulizer, to help loosen any secretions she may have. She's tachycardic with a high fever, so she needs some fluids. In this situation, you consider giving a fluid bolus of between 250 to 500 mils of crystalloid, such as normal saline or Hartmann solution, over 15 minutes. She'll need at least a pink or 20 gauge cannula to do this, so if she doesn't have one available, you need to insert one now. Remember, you're going to reassess all her observations and her clinically after this intervention, so you're going to stay with the patient while this is ongoing. Now she needs some antibiotics. Remember, hospital-acquired pneumonia is most commonly caused by gram-negative bacilli such as E. coli, but also you need to remember to cover things like Staphylococcus aureus. In our trust, we either use Augmentin, so intravenous coamoxiclav, or a cephalosporin such as cefuroxime. You might want to get on and organise some chest physio. And then you need to think about how frequently she needs to have her observations. So every 15 to 30 minutes, assessing whether she responds to treatment. Now, we've established that she's at high risk of deterioration from her new score. So let your senior team know, so your SHO and your registrar. Call the critical care outreach team or the critical care outreach registrar. So we've talked about how to approach a patient with acute shortness of breath after surgery, what the likely differential diagnoses are, how to be systematic in your approach to the patient, using news score to help you identify critically ill people, highlighting what you can do when you first come across an unwell patient in terms of oxygen, fluids and antibiotics, and how to escalate to critical care and your senior team. We really hope you found this critical care podcast useful. We're going to be covering a series of other pathologies and other presentations, so look out for new updates on our YouTube website. In the meantime, why don't you visit www.ucl.ac.uk/anaesthesia. This has a series of resources on both anaesthesia and critical care that are appropriate for final year medical students and FY1 doctors. Many thanks to Dr. DiPaola and Dr. Robert Stevens in contributing to this podcast. See you soon.